Yo, we're live.
Holla.
We got any mods? We got any mods in the chat? Do we got a Ron or a Jamie? I don't know if we do or not. So we're just going to wing it. Hopefully your audio sounds good.
I'm sure it sounds great.
Hopefully the music isn't too loud. Where is the music? It's right here. Let's go here. Just turn down just a smidge. There you go. I think that's better. Pew. Alrighty. Well, let's get this show on the road then, yeah? We've got 9 books this week. I mean, we had more, but we just kind of whittled it down a little bit. Just because some of the other issues we picked up, we haven't really reviewed on the show. And we just wanted to stick to some stuff that we've been keeping up with on the show since we've started. So yeah, we're gonna jump right into Empire and just wrap that thing up, put a bow on it, and move on.
Put a bow on a turd.
I wasn't gonna go that far, but okay. So yeah, let's get it started. So our first book up is the Fantastic Four number 23 Empire technical tie-in. It's a tie-in, but it's still within the Empire or the Fantastic Four series. And we're starting with this book because what happens in number 6, this should be the reading order. You should read this before you read 6, essentially. Would you agree?
Oh yeah, big time.
Yeah. So when we last left off our Fantastic Four read, the Kree child, I don't remember his name, was stolen by the Dark Order or some human Kotati. The
Priests of Pama.
They stole him. And they also found out that they were trying to use a new or another super weapon that was going to be used in this war.
Nullifier.
Nullifier, which basically subjects, the Kree at, you know, depending on who they're using as the source, they push bad memories or, you know, aggressive thoughts into that race. And so that's the whole idea. It's like an amplifier. So anyway, their plan is to use this amplifier to get the Kree to turn on the scroll within the Alliance. And when they turn it on, it actually starts to kind of work. We see the Alliance start to kind of crumble, start to crack. And in doing this, the Kree child sneaks out of her ICU room and tries to go save the boy, the Kree boy, and she ends up getting caught. And so the Order essentially now has both the Kree and the Skrull, so they can inject these negative thoughts or history lessons into both sides of the Alliance to make them turn on each other. So this issue, kind of like in the middle of it, basically we get the Alliance gets undone almost, which I thought was kind of, I will say this, I think that's a really kick-ass concept. I think it's just kind of a neat way to, like, I didn't see it coming. You know, I don't know about you, but I just didn't see that kind of technology being used to undo the Alliance.
Well, it's interesting because there's a question that I had from the Captain America issue 2 tie-in, mm-hmm. where they were standing off against Mockingbird and Wonder Man and Quicksilver, and then all of a sudden they turn on each other and they're just like, yeah, fuck you, no, fuck you, and you're like, wait,
that's right,
what, why are you doing this? And you know, we got that book 4 weeks ago,
yeah,
but now so we finally get to see
why they were exactly kind of acting that
why
way
they were doing that. Yeah.
Yeah, so Val and Franklin are trying to figure out a way to basically stop this. This is their whole thing. And when it gets turned on, it's almost overwhelming for the Alliance and for the Fantastic Four, for Spider-Man, Wolverine, Franklin, and I don't know how to say her name. I don't want to say it. Valeria?
Valeria, yeah.
Valeria, okay. And so when it gets turned on, they don't know how to stop it, basically. Like, they're being it's almost like they're being amplified. They can't break the chain. So while Wolverine and Spidey are kind of taking care of business, and Franklin is too, Valeria has this idea. She's like, oh, wait, like, you know, I can communicate with them, with the kids, and tell them to kind of just chill, basically. Like, I mean, it's more complicated than that, but she basically convinces them to, like, fight their inner demons, fight their, you know, their history, to, you know, not let the old conflict destroy something new, right?
Yeah, and I think what she really does is appeal to, like, the relationship that the two have. Mm-hmm. You know, she says, think about how, you know, how you had to fight and refight every battle of this stupid war, how they made you spend each day of your life trying to kill each other. But remember something else, too. The only thing that stayed constant was each other. And so she's appealing to, like, the family aspect of that,
right?
Which I think is one thing that Dan Slott does really well with this run of Fantastic Four, is consistently resolving plots with, like, this, you know, we're in it as a family sort of a thing, which is kind mm-hmm. of how Fantastic Four has always been.
Is Dan Slott, I'm assuming Dan Slott's staying on like into the next, like, 24-25?
I
enjoyed that part. I started reading Fantastic Four at Empire, and I've enjoyed it. And, you know, outside of RB Silva picking up art on 25, I'm enjoying it. I think I'm gonna add it to my pull list and continue to read, because I know also the stories that are happening in Empire are gonna tie into what's happening in Fantastic going forward. So basically, we get, you know, she appeals to the kids. They break free, and our priest friends, they end up kind of getting what they deserve. Prior to them turning on the machine, Coy basically told them that you will stand in greatness with us. You will, you know, we'll stand side by side. You know, you got to kind of think that through. Like, okay, these guys are plant-based. I don't think it's going to turn up in... It's not going to end up well for anybody that's human, even if you're serving them. And so they end up failing it, obviously. So Koi's like, all right, well, you can still stand in greatness with us, and turns them all into plants. They all, like, vomit plants and turn into trees, and it was pretty gruesome. and then I think... I don't think the... The issue doesn't end, like, it's over. They're like, well, I hope we did our part, right? Like, that's kind of how it kind of ended.
Yeah, they basically, they basically say, yeah, we're all good. Now what do we need to do? They tell them that they want them to take them back to Disney, like they were talking about before this started.
That's right. They want to go to Disney, and they'll probably go. And from my understanding, I think these two kids are going to be part of the comic from now on. It's like we have two more members of the Fantastic Four family. And I'm excited about that. I did like when they got introduced in the Empire Fantastic Four issue 0, I really enjoyed that issue. And I think it's a fun idea. Mm-hmm. I will say this, who the hell is, Wind or who the angel looking who is Sky? That Sky, who is that?
that's Johnny Storm's soulmate. Exactly. It's from the arc right before Empire.
Okay,
so Reed finds out they go to a museum unveiling of the original rocket ship that they took to space, which gave them their powers. Okay. And Reed gets all sentimental and wants to redo the flight on the original trajectory that they were going to go on.
Uh-huh.
And they end up doing it and going to a different galaxy and going to a planet there where they're known as, like, these people that were on their way. It basically gets retconned that the people on that planet, the main leader, unleashed a weapon that stopped them from getting there, and that's actually how they got their powers, was from him unleashing this radiation blast.
Gotcha.
So there, it's like a 5-issue arc called Point of Origin right before this. It's actually really good. I'll let you borrow it. I got all the issues. So
sounds good. All right. Well, yeah, I'll have to read that because I was like, she showed up, and I'm like, who the fuck is this
person? I'm interested in what they're going to do with her as a character because she's... Like, there's so much they can do. She's not from Earth. She doesn't know anything about that, about, you know, Earth. And so there's, like, a lot of, I think there's a lot of room for some good stories there.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Cool. All right. Well, that's Fantastic Four. It wasn't great, but it wasn't bad. It was just kind of meh.
Also, did you see the teaser for issue 25?
Was it a teaser for 25? I don't remember.
They showed like 3 panels. It's not in this book. It was like, I saw it online somewhere.
Oh, yes, I did see that. And yeah, that's basically that basically sealed the deal for me to pick up Fantastic Four until R.B. Silva's off of it. But yeah, I'm excited about it. I'm glad I picked it up. And, you know, we'll get into the deeper conversation when we get to our next book of how I feel about tie-ins. I've been saying it all Empire Run, but I'm really gonna go off in the next book we go. So let's get to that.
Let's do it.
So next book up is Empire number 6. I'll let you start.
Some things.
I'll let you start because I want you, because this was, I know for you, this was gonna be your like big Marvel event. Like you are cosmic through and through. Yep. and you were ready to throw down, and I jumped on because I was, you know, you talked about it, I was like, that sounds dope, let's do it. But I know that you probably have a lot more meaningful feelings about the series in general than I do, so I want to hear what you have to say first.
Well,
about it.
I read roughly 40 or 50 issues of back issues just so I could understand the depth of like the history that this was built on. So as a space person and kind of as like a history guy, like I was really excited for a storyline that it was supposed to be building for so long. And mm-hmm. I mean, now that it's over, I mean, I'm really disappointed, but, so in this issue, we basically get everything put back together. I'm interested in, you know, in why. I know we have 2 more issues. I know we have
Omegas.
The Fallout issues, but like nothing in Empire 1-6 was of any consequence. And I just don't understand how you can build an event like that.
Yeah, I think the thing that they were expecting, and like you said, you did your research. So like, if you've been a longtime Marvel reader, you know that the Skrull and the Kree are just, they absolutely hate each other, right? Yeah. And at the beginning of this series, we get the Alliance, and then we already see cracks in the foundation, right? So I think initially, I think Slott and Ewing were both hoping that everybody had done their homework. And even then, the fact that they built a distrust in the reader, thinking this is not going to last, right? This alliance isn't going to last. And I think they thought that was going to be a lot bigger of an impact on the Marvel universe, which technically it is, right? Because the Kree Skrull war has been the foundation for what, you know, so many different events and so many different storylines within the Marvel comic universe, right? Yeah. But I just don't think, if you're not somebody that, like you said, like you, who's read, you know, a bunch of issues to get caught up, or is that invested, I see why people are just kind of like, meh, whatever. You know, and they kind of established how big this alliance was in the first Zero issue. You know, it's going to change the cosmic economy and the power structure and politics. And we're kind of sitting there going like, okay, you know, like I think they got caught up in it, and it just doesn't seem to be that big of a deal. I don't know. I'm so confused about it because I know it has weight, you know, like I know that this alliance has weight. But you're right. It just doesn't feel like there was anything of consequence that happens. Like, let's just get straight to the end. The alliance stays alive, right? It never fractures, and it will continue on. That is the big drop. You know, that is what they intended, was this alliance is not going anywhere anytime soon. So that's the, in the preview, it was, there's something that's going to change the cinematic, the Marvel cosmic universe forever. And that is that the Kree and the Skrull are now one. They are one giant alliance. And that is big, but yeah, it didn't pop off in this issue. I think even the big action page where the Avengers assemble was kind of like, okay, cool. That looks kind of cool. I will say, you know, Koi and the swordsman going out the way they did, I thought that was pretty cool. It's so unfortunate. It's so unfortunate that the actual, you know, actor that passed away, Chadwick, playing Black Panther.
Yeah.
You know, he was technically like one of the center figures in this book, you know, and we barely got him in this book. We had him in every issue, but it was just kind of like, and there's Black Panther. Right. And there's Black Panther. And then he dies, and then we come to find out that the dude's so OP that he can literally stop his heart almost and stop his bleeding. And he acted like he was dead, and he shows up and ends up winning the day. And you know, I thought that was pretty cool, but it felt so weird, you know, when he did come back, and I was just like, man, this sucks. Like, anyway, that was kind of a tail off. Here's what I'll say here. So obviously the Alliance wins, the Avengers win, the Fantastic Four win. They stop it. We get She-Hulk back. She's seen the Green Door from the Immortal Hulk series. We're going to get a one-off issue here soon, I think in 2 weeks. So we'll find out what she got to see. Maybe we'll get a little insight into the Immortal Hulk in general and what the hell the Green Door is. So I thought that's kind of cool. But the one thing that really, really, really bothered me about this book, so when the Avengers assemble, we're going through this whole thing, and you're kind of looking like, all right, where is he? Where is he? And then who shows up?
Thor.
Fucking Thor. And he's talking about Mother Earth and the spirits of the Earth, and I'm going to use the power of my mother's spirit of the Earth. And we're kind of like, wait, what are you talking about, Thor? You're the god of thunder. And so he uses this like fusion style of lightning and the power of the Earth to defeat the Kotati, and we have no fucking clue where he got that from.
Nope, no idea.
And that's a byproduct of them canceling the Thor series. And I know that they picked certain books to cancel because they needed to save some money, right? They needed, because of, you know, the pandemic. But God, it just sucks. Like, there are two major characters in this book that we never got to see really in action, and it's because their tie-ins got killed. They got canceled.
Well, yes, and so we obviously don't have all the tie-ins, so we don't know if they would have made much of a impact or not. However,
Thor, you know Thor. Well, Thor, yeah. Thor is the, excuse the pun, but Thor literally is the hammer hit that ends the fucking war.
Right.
Outside of Black Panther fighting the swordsman, you literally have Thor talking about some new power, and we have no fucking clue how he got it. It pisses me off. I'm sorry. Continue.
So, we do know that Captain America and the Avengers tie-in had nothing of consequence going into the main event whatsoever.
Not at all.
And so we do know that those could have been left out and we would have been okay. We also definitely know that the Thor tie-in and the Agents of Wakanda or Battle of Wakanda tie-in, that's the entire like main battlefield of the entire plot. Like, why would you take that out? I understand why they took out the Squadron Supreme, the Spider-Man one probably had nothing
Union,
to do with it.
Union, Ghost Rider.
I totally get it.
Yeah.
How are you going to take out the literally the most impactful parts are they're fighting in Wakanda and Thor gains the power to actually end the war. But we're not actually going to tell you about any of that.
So my only thought is that they're playing for the trade and they're playing for the Omnibus, which is a ridiculous gamble because not everyone's going to pick up 175 or however how much you think that Omnibus is going to be. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then there's also no guarantee. Maybe here's the other thing. Maybe they canceled them because they just weren't finished. You know what I mean?
They were definitely finished.
I hope so. Anyway, that was immensely frustrating. Yeah, you're right. Throughout the entire Empire run, we are literally the focus of the Kotati is Wakanda because they want to get to the Vibranium. Why the hell would you cancel Agents of Wakanda? We're going to get so much insight. Unless it really wasn't written that way, which makes no fucking sense, right? So I go back to my original thoughts every time we talk about Empire. Dan Slott and Ewing, they built this event around the tie-ins to an extent.
Yeah.
And they were basically hoping that the tie-ins would fill in the gaps, fill in. And I think that's kind of rightfully so. I think that kind of makes sense in my brain a little bit, but not if the main books don't barely have any context. You know what I mean? Like, yeah, we got, you know, Captain Marvel filled in some holes. Cool. X-Men, not so much. But it was fun. Don't get me wrong. Hickman blew his tie-in out of the water, and it was so much fun to read. But, and I'm glad they didn't cancel it, but that could have been one they could have canceled because it had, like, again, it had no consequence within the Empire story. I think it will have consequence later on down the road in the Dawn of X. I think with Scarlet Witch, Doctor Strange, and with
Magic,
you know, becoming her final form. But yeah, it sucks so much because I don't, you know, we try to stay, we want to be positive about the books that we read, but we're also not going to just let something go by, right? Like, because we care about it that much, you know, we're not dogging it because we think the ideas are radical or anything like that. We're dogging it because it just feels incomplete. It feels completely, it just doesn't feel complete. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, anyway, like you said, not really much things of consequence happen outside of the alliance of the Kree and the Skrull is intact. The alliance does have a new king in the Hulkling, which I do think is badass. You know, we've got a young Avenger essentially in a huge power role, yep, which I think is pretty cool. And, you know, it ends with, I will say the ending was just like, and the end. Yep. It felt so just, let's get this shit over with. And it's kind of disappointing. And I really need Ten of Swords coming up, the next Marvel event, to really hit. I think it will. You know, me and you both are very huge X-Men fans. And we've been basically disciples of Hickman since we read House and Powers. And I can't wait for that one. So I really hope, I know... I'm probably going to regret this later, but I feel like I know that Hickman is going to do it right. You know, like he doesn't just do something and like, eh, whatever. You know what I mean? Like, I feel like he had this round table, that he has these round tables, and he's really going to steer Ten of Swords in the right direction. And I've got high hopes for it. So, you know, that's probably a bad thing for me and us, for both of us. But, you know, I have faith in Hickman. But this... At the end of the day, I'm glad I read it. I'm glad I picked it up, but I'm disappointed. I'm disappointed in it.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. me as well. But in the overall event, I am pretty disappointed. I'm ultra disappointed, not like in Al Ewing, because not everything you do can be perfect, and I am willing to like give you a second chance. But 100%. Like, I'm worried about like the comic community in general writing off Al Ewing after this title. I'm worried that you know, Immortal Hulk is slowing down right now, and people are going to see that and see this and just be like, yeah, he's not that great. And I'm worried that he's not going to, I don't know, maybe get as much opportunities as I think he deserves, because he is a very good writer.
Oh.
He just fumbled on his first big event.
Well, we're about to find that out in the next thing we're going to talk about, so let's just use that as a segue to talk about our next book, which we did an early preview on.
Yes.
We Only Find Them When They're Dead, written by Al Ewing. this book's awesome. You know, it's another one of the, again, we did an early preview, so we're going to kind of just hit on the things that we didn't talk about and kind of speculate on the book as well. Right out the gate, if you haven't picked up this book, go pick it up, whether it's over at Round Store or at Brent's or at any of the other local shops here in town in the DFW area. If you're not in the DFW area, go check out your comic book store. Go get it. This book is going to hit. It is a number one from Boom Studios, and our policy here on Two Fat Guys Pool List is if it's a number one from Boom, just pick it up. But that being said, we both really enjoyed this book. We got to read it early, and it's freaking awesome, man. It's an original idea, and it's got a lot of intrigue. It's cosmic, which, you know, Nate's all about, and I'm slowly getting on that train too. But yeah, so what we have is a group, or humanity in general, in space, and they're basically, they've, which seems impossible, they have scavenged everything that they can in space, yeah. Right? And so on cue, we have these giant beings or gods warp into reality dead, and our scavengers take this as the opportunity to you know, mine for materials, mine for goods and services. And so these beings show up dead, and they mine the meat and the material and the minerals and everything from these, so they use them to continue living onward in space. So we get introduced to this group, or a family, a son and mother, and they see their first god, and you know, they're on the ship that's called an autopsy ship, essentially, which goes in and chops up pieces of bits off these gods to use for, you know, meat and materials and all that kind of good stuff. And we don't really get a lot of backstory in that sense. Like, we get like, what, 2 pages of this family, and then we go whoop, into the future, or present, if you will, into where the kid in the first 2 pages is now significantly older, you know, mid to late 40s, I think. Yeah. And he's got his own crew now, and they're doing the same thing. But there are more of them, and they're getting ready. They're waiting in space for a god to appear. And so they are checking off their lists. They're getting ready for this god to show up. And what they're waiting for are the ringing of 8 bells, literally. And, you know, as they're doing their diagnostics and their checks, each crew member is asked, you know, how are we doing? And they all respond with the same, you know, eight bells, all is well, when they're doing their checks. So that's kind of our catchphrase in this book. And as they go through their checklist, they hear the bells, and boom, the god shows up. And then how about you take it from there?
Well, so after the god shows up, they basically, we start hearing a bunch of people claiming sectors. Basically, what all of these autopsy ships are doing are claiming the spot on the body of that they're going to harvest. Our team decides that they're going to go for the left hand mouth and cheek is mm-hmm. what they decide they're going to go for. Jason, the engineer, says, you know, maybe we should go for the eye. Jelly is selling good right now, which I think is funny. So they settle on the left hand mouth and cheek area. Mm-hmm. So we get a little gruesome little dissection panel. But really, I think what's interesting is what this ship is not doing. They observe that a little fight has broken out. I think it was around the heart.
Mm-hmm.
And a big giant ship is trying to bully like a small scavenger looking ship out of the way, basically saying, you know, this area is our area, we get it every time, get out of here. And then while they're fighting, another small ship has they've like completely turned off all of their signals or something to where you can't see them.
Yeah, they're doing some shady shit, basically.
Yeah, it says they're taking what they can get unlogged and trying to make a getaway. And so this ship is trying to essentially get black market, you know, harvest. And so then we're introduced to what I imagine is going to be our antagonist, Paula Richter, who's the officer on duty in this area, and basically like chases them down and says, listen, you need to stop now or that's it. And they don't stop. So she blows them out of the, blows them out of the sky. It's all sky, but
yeah, they gambled and they didn't win. Basically they put all their chips on red and they lost.
Well, and you know, and they made it apparent, you know, Jason at one point says that a full hold of whatever resource they had was worth about 6,000 bars. But if they sold it on the black market, it'd be worth 20,000. So I just think it's interesting. We get, you know, in just like 2 or 3 pages, we get a lot of insight into the economy of body harvesting.
Well, and what I liked about, well, you know, we'll continue going on in the review, but I'll just kind of do a little detour. What I liked about this book, and I also liked about Seven Secrets, like some Boom books take a little bit more time to build up your world. Like Wind, for instance, like we are just now in issue 3 on Wind, and we're now just getting into the action. And this one, it was like, here's a little bit of history, here's a little bit of story, here's a little bit of action.
Yeah.
And this one, yeah, like Ewing has kind of written this thing where it's got everything. And I think that's why it's so appealing and so intriguing. And there's nothing against Wind. Don't get me wrong. Wind has been a slow build, but it's been really good. Like issue 3, we were like, whoa, here we go. And then Seven Secrets, it's all like action, 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 and questions. You know, like, and this one, we pretty much know what the question is, but it's so big that you want to know. You want, like, you're hooked and you're ready to see issue 2. So our black market guys get blown out of the water or space. And so our crew continues to do their work. They log all their findings. They, you know, pack it up and ready to go. And our officer, what's her name? What's the name again?
Richter.
Richter basically calls up and is like, hey, what's up? What'd you get? And, you know, our George, our captain, or Malik, is very forthcoming, says this is what we have. You know, we're only at the cheek, hands, and where else?
It's just the cheek and mouth area.
Cheek and mouth area. You know, we logged everything. We're clean, man. And he goes, all right, cool. Well, we're going to check your ship, and then we're going to check it again. And then after that check, we're going to check it again. So, you know, nothing is going to slip by Richter. And so they're like, roger that. All right, we got our hull. Let's go ahead and go jump to Hyper and get back to port so we can, you know, get our security checks, our white glove or silicone glove up the butt to find out what we picked up. And so we go into Hyper. And at that point, our captain says, listen, you know, we got 2 minutes until we get back to port. And right now they can't hear our comms. So get your shit straight. we're going to do this. And he goes, but after this, we're going to go try to find, no, he doesn't say we're going to go try. I think he doesn't, he say like, we're going to see a living God. His goal is to find one living, not dead.
Yeah.
And he's going to find it. He's going to do it. So that's how this episode, this is how issue one ends, is we get Captain Malik saying, we're going to take care of business, but then we're going to go on a quest essentially to find a living God. What are they going to do with it? I don't know. What is the living God going to do with them if they find it? I don't know. Pretty sure I would assume it's going to be pretty pissed. Cause I'm assuming it would know that they're harvesting the dead. But we'll see what happens. This issue was really, really fun. The art in it is great. The coloring, great. Writing, great. It's just a fun book. It's a really fun book. And again, Boom Studios, Netflix, they have a deal. If you're not picking up their number ones, what are you doing? If you're not even into, if you're just into straight up collecting or flipping, go pick up a book. It's what, $3.99? $4.99? What are you waiting for? Yeah, like, no brainer. And Ron over at the store, like I said, has got multiple copies of cover A and B. He's got some 1 in 10s. And then next week, Ron will have a store exclusive, which will be $30. We covered it in our preview episode. If you want to check that out, it's on our YouTube and on our logged episodes here on Twitch. It looks freaking awesome. And it's going to be something you're going to want to pick up just to have, you know, for the collection. But again, if you want to flip it later, it'll probably be worth something later on down the road. Just wait, you know? So, you got anything on that?
I was just going to say that the thing that I think that, you know, I feel bad about putting Al Ewing down a little bit because of Empire, but
yeah,
this book shows to me is a perfect example of why Al Ewing, especially when he is not being constrained by, you know, a conglomerate like Marvel's, where he has to make sure that when he's done playing with the toys, he put them back the way he found them.
Right.
And, you know, this clearly the overall plot driver of this book is, why do we only find gods when they're dead? And what are we going to find when we find them alive? Yep. Like, that's the big question. But this isn't a miniseries. This isn't ongoing. So you can't just have that big question and then drag it out for 50 or 60 issues with nothing in between. And I think what this issue does really, really well is it also gives us a ton of small questions that we're slowly going to get answered over time.
We didn't do the whole, like, Richter ended up killing, we totally glossed over it. Yeah. Richter killed George's parents.
Killed Malik's parents. Why did that happen?
Yep.
Is the Eagle Corporation, the big giant ship that bullied the small one, is Eagle Corporation a big, you know, important event? Are they possibly a big bad in the story? Is Captain Malik as bad as Richter implies? Did he deserve that reputation, or is that some type of socio-political issues between the two of them? You know, there's a lot of small questions that I think we're going to get that, you know, when you set up that way, you leave a little bit of breadcrumbs for us to get every single issue, and it satisfies you. It makes you want to come back for more. And I think that's how you make a good comic book series.
I also say that the 1 in 10 incentive cover has, like, for me, like, a cosmic Moby Dick vibe.
Yeah.
Like George or Malik is going to, like, go insane trying to find a living God. That's another kind of thing I got. You know, that's obviously, you know, interpretation, but I can see it going that way.
Yeah, for sure.
Well, there you go. We only find them when you're dead. If you don't have it, pick it up now. It is at your comic book stores. Right, meow. Go get it. Go, 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 go.
And I guess it should be said that this is both of our pick of the week, right?
Yep, this is our pick of the week for both. So there will not be two comics side by side on our Instagram post. This will be the one book sitting on top of all the polls this week. So
you
we finally got
this and the variant next to each other.
Damn it. I probably will. Cool. So next book. Cables. Table number three. Cables number three.
number four.
Four? Shit. I know that... dude, well, didn't we just get a cable issue like a week ago or 2 weeks ago? That's crazy. Let's just get the obviouses out of the way. Artwork, yeah.
Yeah.
Cover, yeah. This, for me, was almost my pick of the week. Just because I'm really digging the time travel... possible clones, what's going on with old man Cable, who's this young Cable, why did he kill his older version, why is the older version leaving a nuclear bomb for the younger version? They're obviously having an open dialogue with each other through time, and I think that's so kick-ass. And then on top of that, fucking Space Knights. You know, we get a little bit of history here. So let's just say it. Last issue, Cable went and stole his old version's arm, whom was killed by him and was being held by Deadpool. That right there, that's a crazy fucking sentence. And so what we find out is that, you know, Cable has promised these Space Knights the ability to time travel back in time to their original planets before it got blown up so that they can go back to their homeworld because it's been destroyed. And so in this issue, we find out that the arm doesn't have time travel in it. It has a fucking bomb in it. It has a nuclear bomb in it. And it has been left to young Cable by himself, by his old self. And that is a question that gets raised of why in this issue. And so the whole reason why this is happening is because Cable wants to get his sword back. He wants to get the sword that belongs to the Space Knights because he likes weapons and it's his new toy. So while he's getting this bomb ready, he is trying to stall, and he has Esme basically... Does she stall for him? I can't remember. So let me pull the issue right now. I've got it right here. I didn't close certain ones. So let's see. Right, so he gets a little bit of a history lesson from Esme about the planet being space science being destroyed, and also that these are basically criminals and science experiment people that got their brains put into these robots, which is pretty fucking crazy. Anyway, so while they're getting this ready, he's stalling to get the sword back, and a bunch more of the Space Knights show up. We're talking like hundreds. Getting ready to be like, hey, we're getting our planet back. We're going to go back in time. And so as we're stalling, Cable's kind of saying like, yeah, we're getting ready. We're going to do this. We need to get out of the city. We need to go, you know, time travel fucks with a lot of things. So we're going to get out of the city to activate the time machine, a.k.a. blow you up. And while he's getting it ready to go, Esme sets up a Krakoa gate that they can jump through when the bomb goes off. Mm-hmm. So as they're getting it ready, we get a flashback to old man Cable setting up the bomb in his arm for his younger version self. And this is where I'm like very intrigued, because
is that
we don't
what's happening there.
Yeah. So in these panels, we get old man Cable basically saying like, you're welcome, you little piece of shit. This is for you. And this is kind of our first evidence that the Cable that was killed, old man Cable and young man Cable, are technically working together. And we don't know why, you know, why would old man Cable, knowing that he's going to get killed, I would assume knowing that he's going to get killed by his younger self, give himself a present for the past. We don't know why. Well, we do. It's to get this sword. So we get this scene where old man Cable is putting a nuclear device into his arm and talking to himself. And then we get a cut scene back to young Cable killing himself and him talking to himself about, you know, him fucking up. It's so confusing, but I dig it so much because I get a lot of Looper. Have you ever seen the movie Looper, Nate?
Yeah.
Like, I get a lot of vibes there with this, but it's kind of switched. No, I think it's right on. Like, the old man is trying to save the younger version of himself. So we're getting that. So after that, Cable finally gets the bomb ready. The robots still think it's a time device, a time machine, And he throws it at him and says, all right, just hold on to this and y'all will go back to your planet. And as the arm is ticking, one of the robots is like, are y'all like sensing some kind of radio or a fission reaction right now? And the robots are like, oh shit, it's a bomb. And they realize it too late. Cable uses his psychic abilities to get the sword back into his hands, and they jump through the gate, and the bomb blows up. Ba-boom. And so the Space Knights are no more? Maybe? Maybe?
Well, we get a little glimpse.
Yeah, we do. So they jump through the gate, and basically it was a date for Cable and Esme, and they seem to have had a good time. And Emma Frost is waiting for them at the end of the other side of the gate and telling Esme to get the fuck over here. You're going home right now. And so it ends on Emma Frost not saying anything to Cable, just doing the meet the fuckers. Like,
yeah, I'm watching you.
I'm watching you. Which I think was just a great way to wrap up the book. And then we get a data page from the Space Knights basically saying they got duped. So they may not be dead. They basically catalog everything that just happened to them. So I think we're going to see more Space Knights here in the future. And I think they talk about the ones that were there, and the last one is in Binary. And I got to wonder who that is, if that's someone of significance or if that's just the last. So there's a list of Space Knights that were there during the explosion.
and the last one is in Binary. Okay.
Correct. And I'm wondering if that's just because, like, it couldn't... the knight that was cataloging it or documenting it couldn't, you know, at that point was getting fried, or if that's kind of a code of, like, who was... like, if that's an important Space Knight or not. So, we'll find out that. And then what? There's a page from the X desk, and that's us kind of getting back into the whole cult of X or whatever they're called. Mm-hmm. Stealing mutant babies. So we're going back. I think we're going back to that at some point. I don't know if we're going to go back to that immediately.
No, I don't think so, because our next Cable issue is Ten of Swords.
So I think we'll get back to that at some point. But then after that, we get Cable back at home on the moon with Cyclops and Jean, and we get kind of a taste of Rebel Cable, Kid Cable. And I really enjoyed this whole family moment, essentially, of him going like, yeah, I can't stay for dinner. I got to go solve a crime about stolen mutant babies. And they're like, wait, what? Get back here. You got to eat. And Cyclops basically says, no, you're staying for dinner. Your grandfather's coming. And so they all sit around the table and have dinner. And the book kind of ends, and Cyclops kind of looks at Cable and says, hey, don't be in such a hurry up to grow up. And, like, us as readers kind of want to know, you know, because there's so much intrigue between the young and old version of Cable. So I think that's kind of, I feel like that's kind of the author saying, like, hey, just enjoy this young Cable, because when shit really hits the fan, it's gonna go down, you know. Yeah. So that's how we get that, and then we get a, you know, next is Ten of Swords. So that's how Cable basically ends. So the next time we're gonna see Cable is gonna be in Ten of Swords Creation, which I cannot freaking wait for.
Yeah, I think we pretty much know exactly what the next almost year of Cable's gonna look like. He's gonna be in Ten of Swords for a while. We're gonna have to, you know, get some type of resolution to this baby kidnapping. Mm-hmm. And then we're definitely gonna see a Space Knight again.
Do you remember the name of the cult? It's like the followers of X or something. Like, they carve X's into their heads, so they're obviously, like,
not James,
big into mutants. Anyway, so that's Cable number 4. I enjoyed it. And again, it was almost my pick of the week, but Ewing's book just kind of blew me out of the water there. So that's Cable number 4. Looking forward to Ten of Swords, looking forward to his series. I really like this character, and again, I hope that who's on the art? Phil Noto. Dude, stay on the book, please. Stay on the book as long as you can. It is so good. Anytime we get a Cable book, even if the story's bad, I'm like, nope. Artwork looks great. So that's Cable number 4. Next up, New Mutants number 12. I don't know. I enjoyed it. I'll say that. You go for it.
Yeah, no, I enjoyed it too. So I'm super glad that we are done with that storyline where they had to go save that girl that had the weird alternate reality bending power. I thought it was so stupid. I didn't care. I was not interested. It did not feel tied to the overall story. Like, I understand what they were trying to do. Like, the new mutants are going and finding new mutants that are just coming into their powers. But, like, except we haven't at all. We haven't done that in any of those issues. None of the Hickman issues did that. None of the Breeson issues with Beak and his family did that. So I just didn't really get it. So I'm glad we're done with that. And I'm glad that we had, like, a self-contained story that still tied into the overall Dawn of X plot. Basically, Magic decides that she is absolutely fed up with this website that keeps basically stalking mutants.
Yeah.
You know, they're finding mutants, they're reporting, they're even cataloging what mutants are coming in and out, which gates, when, what time they're going through, if they've gone back through, you know, stalking them, basically. So she basically decides that they're going to do something about it face to face.
Right.
So I can't remember who all of it. Her, Mirage,
Blob.
And is that it? It's just them three?
I think it's just those three.
Yeah, I think you're right. They show up at the headquarters of this. I mean, really, this is like a stand-in for a Breitbart or a One American Infowars. News, Infowars. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is pretty...
I mean, if you look at the name of the site, it's called Dox Media, like Fox Media. Like, they're clearly taking a jab, or I say clearly. Me being my political views, I took it as them taking a jab at, like, right wing. Yes. But the same can be said for the left. So they're just taking a stand against radical, overly... what's the word I'm looking for? Self-righteous groups or media groups or just people that think they're news.
Right. So yeah, they basically go in, Mirage hacks into their computers and says, you know, look, basically gives them examples of, you know, what has happened. You know, one guy got shot multiple times, like literally as he was trying to go through a gateway. One mom got beaten into a vegetative state. Like, it's actually really brutal. Mm-hmm. A father of four in Australia will never walk again. It was a lot more intense than I was thinking it was going to be. And Magic basically has the leader of this place by the throat with her sword the entire time. But basically what Mirage does is updates their system to where from now on, she says, now every time you post, every time you expose the location, the home, or whereabouts of any mutant, your full name and address will also appear alongside the article, which we believe is only fair. Which I thought was an interesting way to handle this in a non-violent way. Because, you know, that's like one of the creeds of Krakoa is kill no human.
Mm-hmm. But then...
well, yeah. Then Glob gets all mad. And
that's because he basically, the leader, is throwing every vocal attack towards them to the point where Glob just gets, he's fed up with it. He's been abused. He's been through the ringer as a mutant. And I think they all have. I mean, that's the history of the mutants. They can't catch a break, you know, and and Glob just is fed up with it to the point where he's about to beat the shit out of the leader for threatening going after somebody for no fucking reason, essentially. You know, they're publicizing all this information about mutants, but why? For what? Just to hate. You know, that's the idea that we're getting, is that they're doing it just because mutants are different, right? And that's always been the game for the X-Men and for the mutants. It's like, no, fuck you. It's because you're different, so we're going to pick on you. And I think you see a lot of rage that has been building up. And I know it's been dispersed many times throughout the X-Men universe and history, but we just see it come up again in Glob. And Glob's got a little bit more of a backstory than we really know about him. Basically, his dad was, you know, vetting him to be a mutant hater because he was still technically not a mutant when he was growing up. And so he was conditioned to hate mutants. And then, irony, he becomes a mutant. And right. He has become the thing that he was taught to hate. And so he's seen both sides of the coin. And he knows that the anger is misplaced. And that the lack of understanding is misplaced. And so Glob basically loses his shit and goes, yo, if you continue to do this, I don't care. I will kill you. I will kill you, and I will spend the rest of my life in a dark pit with Sabretooth at the bottom of Krakoa if you continue to do this. That's how passionate I am about this shit. And so the leader's kind of like, oh, you know.
Well, and, you know, I think it's interesting that magic leaves such a poignant final say, because she says, yeah, as much as I appreciate a good killing, I think we made our point. You know, let's go home. But then she turns and points at the leader of the group and says, consider this a warning, because there won't be another. And yeah, I don't know. When someone's saying that to me with a like 3-foot sword to my throat, I think I'll probably listen.
Probably listen, yeah.
And of course they do, because the next page is that the website is down for temporary maintenance.
That's great. And then we get the backstory of Glob of finding out that, you know, with his dad and his family and, you know, he just had it. And Magic basically tells him, hey, it's okay. It's okay to do that. It's okay. Everything you did there, right or wrong, everything's fine. And she kind of consoles Glob and says, like, hey, thanks for showing me that, because I didn't know, you know?
Yeah.
And it's just kind of a nice, heartfelt tie. Yeah, to the issue, just kind of giving us some more backstory about the team and kind of making us care more about the characters and some of the not so older versions of the characters. And so that ends, and then we basically get to get another one of those, like, and Ten of Swords is right around the corner, you know.
Yeah.
So
there's one page at the very beginning of this issue, and then two pages here that are alluding back to the Nova Roma stuff that happened in issue 8.
Right.
With Magma. I honestly don't remember that issue hardly at all.
Yeah.
I think it was 8. It might have been 6. It was a while back.
It's way back there.
You know, obviously, I think this is where we're going after Ten of Swords.
Ten of Swords.
Breezin is just trying to, you know,
hey,
let us know.
Look over here.
Maybe if I remembered what was going on, I would be more involved. However, I am super interested in Nova Roma, because all I've read about Nova Roma is the original appearance from the very beginning of New Mutants back in the 80s. Mm-hmm. That's where Magma is from. And it's just so hilariously cheesy and ridiculous. Do you know what Nova Roma is?
I have no fucking clue, dude.
So Nova Roma is basically a Roman city in the middle of mountains in Brazil.
Okay.
That no one knows they're there, and they're hiding, and they've been there since Roman times, and they've still been living like Romans. So they still have centurions, and they ride around in chariots, and they have a gladiatorial pit.
Okay.
No technology and any of that stuff.
Got it.
And so... it's kind of cheesy, but I think it's hilarious, so I'm curious what's going
to
happen there.
You know, I would be much more... I want to know what happened to Sunspot, dude. That's
I want more
cosmic shit.
Yes. And you saw who was writing that.
Hickman,
Those were the Hickman issues.
Yeah, please go back.
Unless Hickman's going to pick up writing on this again, which I don't think he is, I think that was just his little... he loves New Mutants. He's talked about it a lot before. And so I think that he basically told Breeson, hey, when we start out, I want a small... I've got a small storyline I'm going to put in here. And honestly, I think it was a way to take Sunspot and Cannonball out of the picture for a while.
I don't like that.
I don't like that either, but...
Because the other thing is... And I think you picked up that cover. There's a I forget what it's called, but there's a Ten of Swords or a Power 10 cover that you picked up that's like a future scene or something like that, and it's Sunspot sitting on the throne of the Shuri or whatever they're called. Remember that cover?
I think I know what you're talking about.
It's called like a preview color or like a future
spoiler.
Spoiler, right? And there are two. There was that one, and then there was the other one of Omega Red coming through the gate, which we've kind of the Krakoan gate, which we've kind of gotten. Yeah. So like, I'm like, when is that gonna happen? Because I want to see it.
That is Sunspot. I didn't even realize that.
Yeah, dude.
That Sunspot sitting on the throne of the Shi'ar with the what is it called? The Imperial Guard bowing down to him.
Exactly, dude. So like. You know, if that's called a spoiler, where the fuck is it?
Interesting.
Yeah. So I think after Ten of Swords, we might get that. We might, at some point, we might get a Hickman run of the New Mutants again.
Well, I hope so, because honestly, if I had to choose a book to cancel right now from Dawn of X,
Whoa. Let's not get crazy.
I mean, it gets one more arc after Ten of Swords, and that's it. So I give it to issue 20. After issue 20, if it's not doing something, it's out.
Whoa. All right. Well, there you go. So that is New Mutants number 12. We're moving on. Wolverine number 5. So yeah, we got on we had a pretty big cliffhanger at the end of 4. Essentially, Omega Red drowned Wolverine in a frozen lake, and we catch him back in a frozen block of ice being drained of his blood from a drill. And so we have Dracula and two other vampires draining his blood, and they are putting them into like some kind of, they call them like time or blood timers or something like that.
Something like that.
And they're putting them on their chest, and basically it allows them to walk during the day.
Yeah.
They don't fully drain his blood. They actually leave him there. They're like, yo, we got what we're looking for. We're going to let him go because we really don't want to deal with the wrath of Krakoa right now. But we'll get to it. But we're just going to let him go. So they leave him to be in a block of ice, and we get a group of teenage or young vampires who see booty and want to run with it. And so they steal Logan in a block of ice, and being young and reckless as they're driving or snowmobiling away with Wolverine in a block of ice, they hit a couple bumps and he breaks out free, ready to kill. Mm-hmm. So he hunts these vampires. And while this is happening, our two other vampires, not Dracula. Dracula is like, I got other shit to do. I got to run a city. Y'all go take care of, you know, go make more vampires. Our other two vampires are going into smaller towns around the area that they're in Alaska and basically converting everybody into vampires. So they're building an army as we speak. So then we cut back to our Wolverine, and he's hunting down these young vampires, and he finally catches up to him, and he's like, explain to me what the fuck's going on. And they're like, listen, you know, we were just trying to save you, right? But what we find out is that this group actually doesn't, they're not in line or they're not in league with the vampires, the older vampires. They are kind of pissed that they're vampires and they don't really want to be vampires, and they saw an opportunity and they took it. But they want to fight back. They don't want to be vampires. So Logan's like, all right, cool. Well, let's go kill some vampires. So they go on the hunt for the two older vampires. They find them. We have a tussle. Essentially, all three of the young ones die, don't they? They get hearts taken out and heads cut off. And
Yeah, I think so.
I think one of them survives.
Let's see. So this guy, his head's cut off. This guy gets his heart ripped out.
I think the girl survives.
Just standing there.
Wolverine catches up with the older ones, the older vampires, and is like, why did you do that? And they're like, well, we're not going to tell you everything, but just know that, you know, the reckoning is coming, basically.
Right.
And he goes, well, yeah, well, yours is right now. And he kills them. And Wolverine now is, at the end of the issue, basically, is ready to go find Omega Red and go beat the shit out of him. Mm-hmm. For doing what he did. And so that's how the issue ends, right? With him basically going to find Omega Red. And then I think we get a document page about...
Yeah, we do a little bit back before the end. It is him writing to Luis, who we haven't seen since issue one. She's the... She's the one that's hunting the vampires that he meets.
Oh, that's right. That's
the
first
issue. And he basically tells her, yeah, like, you know, Vampire Nation is growing their army. They're up north taking over small towns. They're trucking them into cities and dropping them off. I can't imagine. I'm sure this is going on in every corner of the globe. I don't know what you and your Night Guard are doing to turn the tide, but I've done my part to help the vamps, so now I'm going to do my part to hurt them.
So he's off to go get his revenge and find Omega Red. So then after that we get a page, which initially I forgot about the tie-in. So when it happened, and we'll talk about it, I was like, we're actually gonna get a little, you know, are we gonna get a Donny Cates X-Men book? No.
No.
So, if you haven't heard, Marvel and Epic are teaming up in Fortnite to bring the Marvel characters to Fortnite for a season. And so they're tying in Donny Cates' Thor, Galactus trying to get as much power to fight the Black Winter. And so we see Wolverine kind of in the woods, and he gets summoned by the Bifrost to go somewhere. And it's to go to the land of Fortnite. And so initially when I saw those pages, I was like, oh shit, we're going to get like Wolverine and Donny Cates' Thor. But no, it's just a little bit of a promotional thing that Marvel's doing to get more people to read Marvel comics, which is never a bad thing.
Nope,
so we are tapping our industry muscles and doing some crossover events with video games, and I could not be happier about it. But we'll get to that more later in the news. We're going to talk about that and the backlash that Marvel's kind of seeing right now. But we do get a little preview into that in this issue. So it's not technically canon, but it would have been fucking cool if it was.
No, Marvel has made an official statement. It is canon.
Okay.
Fortnite is canon in Marvel continuity.
Let me rephrase. It would have been cool to see Wolverine in Donny Cates' Thor.
Well, he's in Jason Aaron's Thor, super badass way, but you haven't read that yet, so.
Okay, well, maybe we'll get it. Maybe we will. All right, so that is Wolverine, and we're going to go on to our next book, and that is Guardians of the Galaxy 6. I'm going to let you talk about this one because I got some thoughts.
Okay. Actually, no. I think you should. I want to hear your thoughts before you've heard my thoughts.
Okay.
This was almost my pick of the week.
I don't understand that. It'll be short and sweet. I'll tell you this right now. So basically, it's a therapy session with Nova. It's a therapy session with Nova and him sulking at the fact that he got Peter Quill killed in the first two issues, right? Yep. It wasn't bad, but it didn't hit for me, man. It just didn't. It didn't. I don't care. I don't care. And I guess because I read Donnie Cates's, and it's not that it was Donnie Cates, the previous run of Guardians was so much better than this. That's, I'm just being straight up. Like, I have not, I am utterly confused. I don't know what the hell's going on. Every issue, I'm like, wait, what happened in the last issue? I can't connect. I can't make the connections. Now, I will say, this issue finally showed me some consequence to Peter Quill dying in issue, was it one? Was it issue one? Or was it issue two?
It was issue one.
Issue one. I will say that, like, and I think that's the problem I have with the books is, like, outside of Gamora losing her shit that Peter died, I've felt like this has been a frantic Ocean's 11, and I love that movie, run of Guardians of the Galaxy. Like, hey, we got a job. Bloop, bloop, bloop. Who are you? Bang, bang, bang. Boop, boop, boom. And, you know, we get this issue, which is kind of like a slowdown, repercussions, Nova literally dealing with the fact that he killed one of his friends and technically a crush. You know, we find out that Gamora and Nova have had feelings for each other in this book. But at the end of the day, I'm just like, where are we going? You know, I want to, for me personally, I want Peter back. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know. It just doesn't hit for me. It doesn't hit for me.
Okay. So I have a lot of feelings about
make me like this book.
I don't know that I can. So we are back to Empire again in an essence.
Yep.
But I think in a more positive way. For good or bad, whether it is Guardians of the Galaxy, Empire, Immortal Hulk, the Ultimates, I don't care, you know, Valkyrie, I don't care what Al Ewing is writing. He is tying in a lot of history to everything that he does. He is a badass Marvel historian.
No
and
doubt.
And if you don't know what's going on, then that's your own fault. You need to figure it out. Mm. And as new readers, that's, you know, new to understanding Marvel continuity, Marvel Comics continuity, especially modern Marvel Comics continuity, this can be really tough sometimes.
And it's really, and I'll tell you, like, I'm having a heart. Like, I continue to pick up this book because I want to be loyal to the Guardians of the Galaxy, but it's making it really hard for me with exactly what you just said. Like, I don't know, man. I want it to be better.
So basically what this issue is, I think, is our primer for Richard Rider probably being, if not the leader, one of the main leaders of the Guardians going forward. Mm-hmm. I read in an interview that Al Ewing did before Guardians even came out that one of his favorite things about the original Guardians of the Galaxy when it first came out was that it was full of characters that people didn't know, and so they didn't have preconceived notions about how these people are supposed to act and what they're supposed to do. Mm-hmm. And you know how their powers work, and it just gave it gave Abnett and Lanning more freedom back in the, you know, 2008, 2009 when that was coming out. Mm-hmm. And that he wanted to do the same thing. He was tired of the same status quo for the leader of the Guardians, and that something needed to change. So I'm going to go ahead and let you know right now, I guarantee you Peter Quill is not coming back for probably a couple years.
Oh, I no doubt. I guess.
And because of that, I think that's why we get, that's one of the reasons why we get this issue, is we're transitioning Richard Rider into that position.
Right. And I'm not opposed to that.
Right.
It's, I don't know. The pacing of this series has just been off for me. Maybe that's what it is. Like, it's not that I can't follow the writing. I think I can. It's just the pacing for me is just not there. And I'm not excited. It sucks saying this. I want to be excited to pick up the next Guardian issue, and I don't get that. I just don't get it. And well, I want it.
Well, this single issue isn't going to change that.
No, you're right.
And this issue, in a lot of ways, on its surface, even left me wanting more. Because one of the things I really liked about this issue was that it was sort of a quick, I don't want to say wrap up, but like a quick, you know, Richard Rider history, if you will. Mm-hmm. Because there is a lot of history between Nova and Gamora that, mm-hmm. you know, if you didn't read some of the Annihilation stuff, Annihilation and Conquest, like you just wouldn't get. You know, they've been through absolute hell together. So there's obviously like a bond there. And I think that this issue was good for setting up what their relationship is going to look like going forward and the fallout from Peter being gone.
Right.
I mean, I'm going to continue to pick it up, but I just needed to, I don't know.
However, nothing that I have said got this issue to come anywhere near a pick of the week for me. What made this book a pick of the week was a big time Marvel comic book tackling mental health issues.
Okay. Yeah, I can see that.
That, for like, I know for some people, they just read this and it was just like, oh, look, Peter's at a shrink. But I can tell you right now, Al Ewing's been to the therapist before, because this is a lot of these panels and a lot of the stuff that this Shi'ar funded therapist says hit home and was very real. And I think that tackling, you know, mental health can be really taboo sometimes still somehow today.
No doubt.
And so the fact that we can tackle that in a comic book makes me feel pretty good. I like that. I like that Al Ewing took that risk. And I also like that he took a non-conventional way to essentially give you a history lesson on Nova. He could have done it in any other way. As a matter of fact, I just got through reading a Nova annual from 10 years ago. And they basically tell Richard's story by having a conversation with the robot in his head. And it's just not very creative.
Mm-hmm.
This is a much more creative way to give you a little bit of a backstory into him. So when you take that part out, it's a average B issue.
Yeah. Like I said, to me, outside of it just not really hitting for me on the pacing, I did like the connection, you know, from issue one and how Nova is dealing with, you know, the death of his friend and how he hurt Gamora. You know what I mean? Like, mm-hmm. I did like that about this, but I'm ready to, I guess in the last couple issues, the action and the story that they're building, it just didn't make sense to me. I was like, I don't really care about this. Like, I just didn't, I didn't care about it. I did care about issue one and Peter going away. Like, that was a giant cliffhanger. And I feel like it was like, and this is kind of like, yeah, we're kind of getting back. But again, it just doesn't feel like, I just still feel like we're just still trying to get the wheel to turn so we can really start hitting where we want to go with this issue, with this series. Yeah. You know, where are we going? Not necessarily the end game, but, you know, give us a direction. And I don't feel like we have that yet. Like, we're getting close, but
I agree.
Ron says, it's the new triad of Peter, Gamora, and Richard. And then saying Jean doesn't get all the fun.
So. Yeah, I mean, I think what you're saying is valid. And I think, for good or for bad, a lot of the post-Empire, how is this changing cosmic, is going to happen in this book.
Well, yeah, and that's how we kind of get into the issue, is we find out that the Kree, you know, Nova finds out that the Kree Skrull Alliance is a real deal. Like, it's a real thing, and that is the first time we've actually seen some kind of weight in what happened in Empire, because Nova was like, wait, what? What'd you just say?
Right.
So there's that. So there's Guardian 6. We'll see what happens next. You know, we're assuming we're probably going to deal with that alliance, or, you know, finding out more about that. So, you know, we'll see what happens. Again, I'm going to continue to pick it up, but I might do what you're saying in the next two arcs. If we don't, start moving, I might drop. Yep. So, ooh. So next up, Marvel Zombies Resurrection number one. So we got
not
one
to
of
be
these.
Confused with Marvel Zombies Resurrection number one
from October 2019.
Yeah,
which set up the story. I think there was an issue with the it, that should have been either zero or alpha, and then this is one.
I don't know what happened there.
That's kind of weird. Anyway, so in the last issue, everybody was like in space except for Spider-Man and like Val and Franklin, and they went to go see a disturbance in Galactus, and we come to find out that he's infected with something, and everyone turns into zombies. That's mm-hmm. the last issue, and then that last issue ends with Galactus's body falling on Earth.
Yeah.
What? So we get a lot of like back and forth of timelines in this issue. We get I've never in the issues that I've read of Marvel Zombies, I've never gotten the sense of like The Walking Dead, and I'm not saying I get that in this, but we do get the typical like group of survivors just trying to survive.
Oh yeah,
right?
See, I definitely get that feeling from this.
Well, the only reason why I don't say that is because the zombies that we get in this book, and this has been a typical form of Marvel Zombies. They're not like, you know, they're not like that. Ones. Yeah, they have a soul and they have a personality. And so what I get different from these Marvel Zombies from the previous ones that I've read is that there is a hive intelligence going on amongst our zombies. And they're all working for a greater goal. So we start off with Valeria and Franklin, who in the past has black hair. Did you not notice that?
Notice what?
Franklin, at the beginning, you know, when the Galactus body is falling, mm-hmm. he is obviously the same age as Valeria, and he has black hair.
Yeah.
Right? When we go into the present of what's going on, he obviously hasn't aged, and he has blonde hair.
Yeah.
Explain that one to me.
Well, that's part of the cliffhanger that they keep saying what happened. Like, they don't understand what's happening to him.
Okay.
That he's
so,
aging.
Gotcha. But why did his hair change?
I don't know. For the same reason he's not aging.
Super Saiyan thing? Anyway. So that all happens, and at some point, Peter, like, while this is going down, he gets knocked from their little spaceship that they're flying in, and he bumps his head, and I think he loses his abilities, or he doesn't lose his abilities, he's just kind of disconnected. So when we cut to the present, we've got Valeria.
He gets punched in the face by Johnny Storm and gets scarred in the face.
That too. Right, okay. Burned, scarred. So when we find our friends, it's Peter Parker, Forge, Valeria, Franklin, who has no powers and won't age, so Valeria is much older. And who's the other girl?
No idea.
Moon.
Yep. Something like that.
Moon Ting. Moon.
I don't know. Man.
Need to figure it out because we have to reference her, so we need to find it. Moon. We're gonna keep going. I was kind of hoping Ron would be like Moon something.
I'll find it. You keep going.
Anyway, we've got this group that is, they're trying to, you know, just survive. And Forge is basically saying, like, let's go this direction. And not inadvertently, on purpose, leads them to the old Charles Xavier School for Mutants. And Spidey's kind of like, or Parker's like, what the hell are you doing? Like, this is like a no-no zone. Like, we can't go in there. Like, this is like a trap. And Forge is like, listen, if we go here, we can kind of find some shelter. We'll be fine. Side note, the weapons that they're using are effing dope, right? So Forge is using a gun with the skull and eye visor of Cyclops.
Yeah.
So he's shooting Cyclops laser beams as a gun, which is kind of cool.
Moonstone.
And then Moonstone.
Yes.
Who is Moonstone?
I don't know.
Yeah, okay. Don't know. Ron, if you're here, please tell us who Moonstone is. Anyway, so Valeria has a gun, and it's literally a gun that has a hand that looks like this, right? And I think it's Johnny, I think it's her uncle's hand that shoots flames, if I'm not mistaken. So they both people have guns that are made of zombie body parts that have still have powers in them, which I think is hilarious. And only Forge would make a weapon like that.
Of course.
So they're going into this they're going into the Xavier school, and they end up finding a bunch of humans, not mutants, locked up in the house. And so they liberate them. And as they liberate them, they find out that somebody's been keeping them there, and it's other mutants. And these mutants have been keeping them there as sacrifices to stay alive from some being that's been haunting them or keeping them hostage. Got her powers. So Moonstone got her powers from fusion with Gravity Stone designed by the alien Kree.
Yes.
So that's Moonstone. Interesting. So these mutants are like, you know, why did you take out our hostages? Now we're going to have to get killed. And right as they say that, somebody shows up and is like, fee, fi, fo, fum, where's my food? Took Captain Marvel's place in Dark Avengers. Okay. Yeah, she definitely had a Moonstone definitely has a Captain Marvel vibe for sure. And we find out that the being that is being fed in the mansion is Beast. And right before this, we got this huge like Forge basically going gaga over Beast, and he's my friend and I really trust him and blah blah blah. And so when Beast shows up, he's kind of like, he's not mindless, but he's got one directive. And what that directive is to get the Reed's kids, Franklin and Valeria, get them back to Galactus's body. They're the key to something. And so Forge is trying to talk some sense into Zombie Beast. And Zombie Beast kind of like is like, oh, yeah, like it seems like it's kind of working. And then Forge gets ripped in half. Just flat. So Forge is dead. And that was my oh shit moment this week. I was like, oh shit. So Forge gets killed. And then I don't remember how they kill Beast. I know they cut his head off.
Yeah.
And it's still kind of alive, and Valeria is able to get some information out of the head to the point where they know that they can get back. They can go find everybody. Find everybody that went on that mission to Galactus and find everybody that's stuck in his body. And so that's kind of the Richards's kids' goal. They want to try to go find their family, even though they know that they're already zombies. And so that's their goal. And all Peter wants to do is just survive. Like, he doesn't want to get into any more trouble. We also find out that Peter is dealing with like a sensory overload with his powers. And that his powers actually could kill him. His spidey sense could literally overload and kill him because there's so much danger going on around him that he could literally like have a stroke and die because he's constantly in a panic mode because his spidey sense just is going off all the time. And also, we kind of skipped over this. Peter has built or has taken over a sentinel to be like a caregiver / nanny of Franklin and Valeria, which I think is kind of funny.
Yeah.
So through all of this, the kids are like, hey, you know, we scanned the skull of Beast. We know how to find Galactus's body. Let's go find it. And Moonstone's like, I'm out. I'm done. I've had enough. Peter, good luck. I want you to survive. And she pieces out, right? Yeah. So they camp out for the night, and somebody finds something. I don't remember. Or no. The kids basically like took off for a hot second, and they get captured by a zombified Moonstone, so she got corrupted.
Literally in like two pages. She's like, yeah. See you later. Actually, no, wait, I'm
a zombie. Yeah. So she gets corrupted and she's about to kill everybody. And right as she's about to do the final blow, our favorite vampire slaying hunter, Blade, shows up and turns her into sushi. And I literally liked the copy blurbs that the like her body just turned into Play-Doh and just got cut in half. And so we end the issue with Blade basically joining Peter, Valeria, and Franklin to go to Galactus's body. And who wouldn't want Blade as your bodyguard? Like that's pretty cool. So that's how that issue ends. I thought it was fun, but I did not find it as entertaining as the first issue, number one. Yeah. But it's a four-part series, so it's not like we're going to be in it for that long. I'm going to continue to pick it up. I'm definitely intrigued to see like how Galactus plays into it and what's really corrupting everybody. And it's kind of nice to see Peter Parker not a zombie in the zombie series. He's always usually a zombie. So I enjoyed it, but I didn't enjoy it as much as the first number one, which sounds so weird to say.
excuse me. I honestly probably was going to just say I'm done with this until two things. One, the little preview for the next issue says next the Phalanx Wall.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Which I like the Phalanx. I think they're pretty dope. So that intrigued me. And then I somehow just didn't pay attention to the creative team at all. And then I looked and saw who was writing this, and it's Philip Kennedy Johnson, the guy that is currently writing Last God. So
you're sticking on.
I like his writing enough on that book to stick around to see what's happening on issue two.
That's interesting. So he's writing a DC book, but then he's allowed to go write at Marvel. So I guess he doesn't have an exclusivity deal like some of the other writers.
He's a brand new writer. He's only got like four or five titles under his belt.
Gotcha. Well, cool. Yeah, no, I'm all about it. And again, like this book is so much in my, you know, I don't know if you've read any of the other zombie stuff, but this book is definitely different from the first two zombie series.
I have not.
So that's the other reason why I'm kind of intrigued, because not that those books weren't good. They are. They're really good. But this one's definitely different than the first two. I know there's more. I think there's like three and four. But it's definitely different. It reads completely different than those series, which those are fun. Don't get me wrong. They're fun. But this is definitely it's a different take for sure.
Yeah.
All right. You ready for your solo book?
Yeah.
All right. Here we go. Last book. King of Nowhere, number 5 from Boom Studios.
Yes, so King of Nowhere number 5, this is the last issue of this miniseries. I really enjoyed this little 5-issue series.
Wait, can I just jump in real quick?
Yes.
Ron says, will this book tie into what Cates is doing with Galactus? Question mark. That's a good question. Good question.
I hope not.
Why not?
Because I don't like zombies. They're dumb and boring.
Okay. Continue. Sorry.
So basically, we get.
I don't think they're dumb and boring.
I know. Basically, we get the final confrontation of basically the sheriff and his supporters, you know, kind of doing their little showdown against his daughter and their supporters. You know, names aren't used hardly at all in this book, so I am not going to remember anybody's names. But basically, our main character has, you know, found out that the reason why all of these people are deformed looking and have, you know, horns and wings and extra arms and stuff is because they're part of a government experiment on what would happen when you expose people to radiation over time. And then they essentially close the borders. But you find out that the sheriff, who's totally human, but has a deer daughter.
What are you talking about?
Yeah, I know. If you're not reading this book, then it doesn't make any sense. Basically, you get a final confrontation. This is the final confrontations and everything. So, the fish boy and the guy with the staple gun are battling each other, which has a really nice, satisfying ending. And I just realized that there's no way to explain this without it just sounding like that. The iguana that we see, the giant, 20-foot iguana that we see throughout, kind of, moping around in the background, finally comes out and eats the sheriff, but then pops out just his head. I guess he didn't want to eat his head.
You could literally be making all of this shit up, and I would never know.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not making any of it up. Okay. So, basically, if you can't already tell, this book is very esoteric. It's not very literal. It is having a double. We're telling two different stories, basically. One is the story of this guy who's an alcoholic and him kind of coming to realize that he needs to be better. And we're also getting a little bit of a social commentary on not trusting the government.
Gotcha.
I think what happens in this book about the actual characters, even though I can't even remember any of their names, by the end of the fifth issue, I genuinely care about what's going to happen to most of these people, which I think is really good writing. But the thing that makes this book stand out the most by far, way more than the writing, which is good. And this is W. Maxwell Prince. That's the guy that's writing Ice Cream Man right now. It's good writing, but the art in this book is phenomenal. And you will, whoever looks, I don't think anyone looks at this book and goes, yeah, it looks pretty good. You're either going to look at this book and say, this is garbage trash and throw it away, or you're going to look at it and say, this is absolutely phenomenal. There's no standard blocking or framing in this book. Everything is hand drawn. Every frame, every square, every panel is all hand-drawn. This is a husband and wife duo, Tyler and Hillary Jenkins. Basically, Tyler does all of the pencils and inks, and Hillary comes back over with all the colors. If you wanted to see what two, bohemian hipster people would make a comic book look like, that's what this is. Gotcha. If you want to see that people that learned about art from Etsy and I don't know, I was just trying to think of that other girl app. I couldn't think of it. What's that app where you save a bunch of pictures of different things and people use them for their wedding and stuff to save pictures?
Nope.
Never mind.
Whoop.
Anyway.
You already said Etsy, right?
Yes.
That sounds like what you're saying. Yeah.
Basically,
Pinterest. Pinterest.
Pinterest, yes, thank you. That's exactly
what it is. Then we're on Pinterest.
If you want to see what it would be like if people that learned how to do art only from Etsy and Pinterest.
Go team.
That's what this is. But that sounds like such a knock. But I think this art is so reminiscent of our generation. You know how you can look at someone dressed from the 80s and you look and you go, yeah, they're definitely from the 80s. You just totally get it. When you look at this art, you're going to go, whoa, 2015, 2020, for sure.
Gotcha.
And I loved it. I thought it was really good. They've done a couple books together. I think Grass Kings is one of them. I'm going to go back and get them all just because the art is so good. I love it.
Do you not have all these?
No, of their other work.
Oh, gotcha.
Yeah.
Well, cool. And this is an ongoing series?
No, this was the final issue.
Oh.
So it's just a 5-issue series. Easy to commit to. Easy to...
I like those sometimes. I mean, sometimes I want it to, I especially like 5-issues or however many issue series when it's... As much as it breaks my heart when you're the end and you're no, I want more. But I do like those.
I think this is a good example too of a book that I, this is one of the first books that I picked up after I established my must buy every boom number one rule. And it just goes to show you that, honestly, I don't think this will ever get turned into anything in any way, but it just kind of shows you that you know, that
mindset, you never know,
it opened you up to things that you really like, you wouldn't know about.
Yeah, for sure. And I think that's the beauty of comics, is especially the independent books, is just you get so many like out there ideas that some of them are just like, dude, I never thought of that. And I think that's the beauty of our hobby, is we get books like this where we can just kind of be like, fuck yeah, that was dope, you know. And that's the fun thing. That's one of many things that draw me to this community and this hobby in general.
For sure.
Alrighty, well, that is our pull list for the week. We're going to go ahead and talk about a couple things that are going on in the industry, and then we're going to hit on our pull list for next week, and then we're going to end the stream, and then I might turn it back on and play a little bit of Avengers, so if you want to stick around and watch that, might do that. So, we're going to talk about, the first thing we're going to talk about is, we kind of alluded to it a little bit with Wolverine, and that is Marvel partnering up with Fortnite to bring comics to a new generation of readers. And the controversy that they brought with them.
I'm so shocked that there's controversy with this at all.
Really? Are you? Are you, though?
I'll always be shocked by stupidity. Even if it's like expected, like I won't be shocked when like Trump is stupid. Like that's just like he's always stupid. But I just expect comic people to not just always be stupid. But sometimes comic people can be stupid.
Give us a little bit of backstory here, then.
I mean, there's not a lot of backstory. So, you know, this isn't the first time that Marvel.
Whoa! Let's start. Whoa. We need to start.
March 12, 1990. I was born.
We need to start at the genesis of this, which is I was driving to work and then eventually to the comic book store, because where else am I going to go on a Tuesday? Or Wednesday. And I get a text from Nathan, and he goes, I know what I'm going to talk about for our news segment. I'm about to go off. And I didn't even text him back. I just called him. I was like, give me tea. Sip. And, you know, Nate has been on the Reddits, on the internets. And there is the group that we always allude to majority of our episodes of cranky. I don't want to say originals. I don't know how to describe them, like where they fit. Excuse me, within the chasm of comics, you know, like I don't know how to categorize them.
I'm not sure either.
They're whiny, like, bitches.
Like faux enlightened, but it doesn't matter. I'm not even gonna try to categorize them.
Right, so they're up in arms. They're pissed that Marvel has decided to partner with Fortnite to bring comics and the characters to the game. And, you know, for me and Nate, yeah, we've played Fortnite. We were actually playing the season a little bit. And all we see outside of obvious dollar signs is an effort to get more young and or people that are not exposed to comics into the comic book stores to buy comics and read them. Yeah. And I think that's the goal that we try to do with this show, is just to be like, yo, get off your butt and go read some comics. Go to your LCS, go to Collected in Fort Worth or in Keller, or go to Duncanville Bookstore or Wild West or Pegasus or Zeus or whatever, and go pick up a comic book, because they're really badass. And we've got this group of people that are like, oh, they're sellouts and they're just trying to make money. And duh.
Right. Yeah. Like a multi-million dollar company isn't going to
try to make money. I mean, what are you doing?
What's irritating is to me is, one, this isn't the first time that Marvel has teamed up with Fortnite. This is not even the second time. Like, they've done, they did Thanos back in 2018 when what was it, Endgame came out?
Because the Russo brothers liked Fortnite, so they were like, hey, let's team up, and duh.
And then it was a few months ago they did the Deadpool, Deadpool, Domino, and Cable?
Yeah.
Yeah, like...
Which, yeah. Again, I'm pissed that I missed that. I really hope they bring Cable. Like, I hope Cable... Because that was a buy skin. Like, you could buy it.
Yeah.
And if that comes back into the store, yeah, I'm buying that. Anyway.
And so now, you know, they've done it again, but now they've actually tied it in with a comic. Which, by the way, the comic is free. You can get it online and read it. It's good. It's silly.
Excuse me? It's free?
Yeah.
What?
It's free. Literally just go to marvel.com and read it. That easy. Yeah. But it's also written by literally the hottest comic book writer in comics right now.
Duh.
Like, what? So...
I think these people also don't like Donnie Cates because Donnie Cates is ruining my Marvel.
Oh, yeah, I don't.
Remember that video I sent you? That video, that one guy that's like, Donnie Cates, stop messing with my Galactus, Holmes. Like,
yeah.
Galactus has been killed by every other fucking writer in the Marvel, like currently writing Marvel. Get over it. Get over it.
Well, and I mean, we can't have the same stuff over and over again, but
no.
What I don't understand, or what really irritated me, is that people sometimes like get embarrassed when they're wrong,
mm-hmm.
or like when so one of the things I saw was people were speculating on what that last page was supposed to be. They were like, Donnie Cates, and Wolverine's going into the Donnie Cates Thor, and then some people were like, Thor is coming to Ten of Swords. That's why, because we know next Wolverine is in Ten of Swords, why else would this be here? It's like, well, I do understand why people think that, but especially if you're not a gamer and or you don't like Fortnite, you don't keep up with common current comic book news, I don't understand why you wouldn't if you weren't a comic book reader, but I can understand how people didn't get it. And so people just chimed in and said, hey, those are cool theories, but it's just a marketing thing for Fortnite. Wolverine gets brought to the Fortnite thing so he can be a character. Like, it's not a big deal. Like, it's just Fortnite. And then people are like, whoa, what? Fucking Fortnite? Like, oh my God, how could you do this to my comic books? And luckily, by that night, my feed on Facebook was overwhelmed by a lot of people in saying, like, hey, like, I own a shop. I work at a shop. And I had kids coming in looking to buy comics for the first time. Someone said, literally posted a screen or posted a picture of a picture that he took of three kids that came in, and they were all holding, what was it? Now I'm not going to be able to remember. Is it Champions? That's the, all the kids, teenager ones. Mm-hmm. I think it was a bunch of Champions number one. Anyway, he was like, these kids came in and literally said, we want comics from those guys in Fortnite. Like, we want stories about those guys in Fortnite. Like, that's all they said. That's all they wanted. And so, and they didn't even get that. That's the best part, is they didn't even get it.
No.
Like, the shop owner recognized that, yeah, I can give you that, or I can probably give you something that you're going to relate to a little bit better, that's a little bit more age appropriate. Because they were pretty young. I would probably put them at like 10
Marvel
years old.
Is putting the readers into the comic book shops. They're getting the new readers in there by hitting the medium that they're playing.
Yeah.
And I just, again, it's these old, not even old, it's just these cranky dudes that just...
That's how you grow your platform. I mean, and it's frustrating... It's frustrating for me because I haven't been in comics forever. And so I'm sure in 10 or 20 years, something's going to happen and I'm going to be like, oh, I don't really like that. But I'm not going to be like, on Facebook going crazy.
Ron just said, and obviously shop owners love this. They want the new business.
Of course.
They want new readers. If you don't get, if the base
continues to age, you're not going to be able to sell anybody because at some point they're going to die. You know, and you need to have that engagement. The Marvel movies did this, obviously. When the Marvel movies started getting hot,
that's what I was just about to say, because you know when these movies started, people were like, yeah, they're gonna get everything wrong, they're gonna ruin all the stories that I've loved. I've been reading Fantastic Four since 1961, and they're gonna ruin everything. And you know what, these movies got people like you and I in there, which are now in a comic shop 4 or 5 days a week.
That's
all because of these.
Yeah.
I'm not trying to put our business out there, but
I mean, you know, I've done one. There was a week where I literally went every fucking day.
But what I'm saying is, if you know, if that's what can happen, right? If like if outside mediums can draw you into comic books, people buying more comic books is better for comic books. And if you can't see that, you're dumb.
And like, also, you're
stupid.
Kudos to Marvel for taking the initiative to do it. And then you got DC that's like, eh, let's cut back a little bit. And, eh. Like, I don't see a lot of initiative from DC at all. And I see Marvel being like, all right, how do we... And maybe we will see an initiative from DC because that's our next story. But... as of right now, DC doesn't... it just seems like they're sitting on their hands. Like, hey, we're going to get rid of our distributor. We're going to do our own thing. Oh, we're cutting a shit ton of titles. Yeah, because it's AT&T. AT&T doesn't give a shit. They don't care. They just want to see profit immediately. And they don't realize that it takes time. It takes time to build. And it's because they've never sold this medium. They've never sold the story. They've never sold the paper. It's all been digital. It's all been service. And so I just don't see that initiative for them. And kudos to Marvel for saying, how do we get younger readers to read our material and get them into our shop, into our owners' shops, because they are the lifeblood. They sell our shit, so we need to support them. And that's what they did. And yeah, kudos to Marvel for doing another game changer thing and working with a, you know, multimedium and getting their product into different things and engaging with younger readers and or readers like us that probably never thought about buying comics or haven't bought them in a long time and then saw that while they were playing Fortnite and were like, hey, I know there's a comic book shop right down the road. I'm going to go check it out. And, you know, I can't tell you how many times I've gone to run shop. And again, I've, you know, obviously I'm fairly new, but every time I go, it seems to be getting busier and busier. You know what I mean? Like, and I'll hear somebody that's like, hey, you know, I used to read X-Men when I was a kid and he's like my age. And he goes, where do I start? And then you see Ron go and be like, yeah, well, here you go. This is where you want us to, you know what I mean? And I just feel like we're getting more and more of that. And it just makes me more and more excited about being part of this community and pushing more and more into this medium. So
I have a quick story that just for that. So I went to go pick up my daughter today, but she was just waking up for her nap. So she needed like just a little bit more time. So, you know, I ran by Ron's store real quick because it's right down the road. Mm-hmm. And I went in and I was just, you know, browsing some new books that were up on the top. And there's this guy that, well, you know, again, comic books are for all people. And this guy, like, was a stereotypical guy. Like, he had tattoos everywhere, bald head, gold chain, like... just did not seem like he was a guy that was typically into comic books.
Mm-hmm.
And he was almost squealing on the phone. He was so excited.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what originally brought him into the store. I think whoever he was on the phone with, it sounded like it was a significant other. He said babe a couple times, so I can assume.
Mm-hmm.
He was like, I think he went there to buy a comic book for whoever he was talking to. And... He was like, oh, do you need 15 or 16? And they were like, they said something, and he was like, well, they have both. And then they're like, well, no, look, he's got 9 through 16. And then I literally saw him grab, they grabbed them all. And then he started looking at statues and started talking about statues. He's like, oh, man, they got Dragon Ball Z here.
Yeah.
Like, he started getting, like, so pumped and so excited. And he was, like, walking around, and I don't know. I just thought it was really funny. And really cool that this guy was like a kid in a candy shop just like looking at, and like he probably did four circles around just while it took me to go through like two short boxes.
Right. Yeah. No. And that's just no more of that is encouraged. And I think Marvel is going in the right direction instead of like, obviously they've taken some step backs on some issues. You know, we've talked about it with Empire and some other series that were in our pull list that got canceled, but for the most part, they're continuing to move forward and they're trying to find more ways to engage with new readers and current readers. And I just think it's only to go up. You know, I think it's very encouraging for our hobby that they're doing that.
Yep.
So next up on the DC or talking list is talking about DC is DC has hired a new general manager for DC. Let me push my little Streamlab deck. Boop. Hey, it worked. So this is just some interesting news. I don't know really how to make or what to make of it. It seems like an odd move to me. I could be wrong. It's just my interpretation. But they hire Daniel Cherry as GM. He's a former esports exec. And they're adjusting the role of Jim Lee over at DC. And the way they kind of word it, it seems like they're saying, like, you know, Jim will be able to have more of a DC brand focus with this guy being in charge. But to me, it just kind of reeks of like, well, this guy knows what, you know, he's worked in this medium that we're trying to get into, so let's hire him. And I just don't know if that, I don't know. I'm just speculating. I just don't feel like it's the right move. I don't know. What do you think?
I really don't know.
What? What are you laughing at?
Are you laughing at me? Are you talking to me?
Nothing. Go ahead.
What?
You're fine.
Are you talking to Meg?
No.
Oh, okay.
So, I mean, I don't know. Like, I can't possibly think of what this guy is supposed to be able to bring to the table that would help with comic books. But I'm trying to read
So I'll go ahead and read it. So former Activision Blizzard esports executive Daniel Cherry has been named senior vice president and general manager of DC. Let's just say this. Blizzard, like the fact that he was part of Activision, that kind of is a red flag for me because they've been in a lot of hot shit too. So it just doesn't, and it hasn't been nice for the consumer or for the user over there. So that to me already tells me like, why are you picking up this dude? Because he already doesn't. He's kind of got a black eye with that group of people that were engaging with Activision and Blizzard. according to the Hollywood Reporter, Cherry's role is the newly created position covering business affairs, business affairs, editorially, talent services, marketing, sales, brand, and direct-to-consumer, along with overseeing business development. The addition of Cherry will allow Chief Creative Officer and Publisher Jim Lee to take on a more DC brand responsibilities. Cherry will begin his DC duties on September 8th. As for Lee, new responsibilities, DC said Lee will bring his unmatched creativity, passion, and intimate knowledge of the DC characters and canon to the company's efforts to involve the brand and create relevance for new audience around the world. Cherry's role as Activision Blizzard involves broadening the studio's esports reach. He was previously the chief marketing and innovation officer of NHL, NHL's the New Jersey Devils. Okay. DC has undergone a restructuring after Warner Brothers laid off a bunch of people in August. Blah, 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 blah. Yeah, I just don't know. Like, if I'm a DC fan, I'm kind of going, I mean, and I'm not, and I'm kind of going, what? It just doesn't. It doesn't make sense to me.
Yeah, I think this is a move that just it sort of shows you that once again, DC's not quite, or the people making the decisions for DC aren't quite in touch.
AT&T.
Right. But I'm saying like the actual humans responsible are not in touch with what needs to happen. I think if anything is going to be salvageable for DC, it's going to be through Jim Lee.
Let's hope so, and let's hope he stays. Like, you know, I feel like if this doesn't work out, Jim might, I don't know. Again, I'm speculating, and I don't want to be that guy that's like, you know, I'm not saying I want to see DC fail. Obviously not. But I really hope they don't lose Jim Lee in the process of what they're doing over there. Like, that would be a huge blow to them and the industry in general if he ends up splitting.
Yeah.
So we'll see what happens. You know, we're, me and Nate are both very novice readers, and we haven't picked up a lot of DC. You know, there's a couple books here and there. We're reading The Three Jokers. But, you know, I've always said, like, if there's another reboot, I'll give it a shot. You know what I mean? I'll give a shot to Batman and Superman and, you know, Green Lantern if they do it. I'm just waiting for it, because right now I just don't know what the hell's going on.
Yeah.
So we'll see what happens. You know, it's a very evolving situation over at DC, Warner Brothers, and AT&T. And, you know, we can speculate all day if they're going to continue to do comics. Are they going to do print? Are they going to go straight to digital? We don't know. But it just seems like there's a lot of mess going on, even though that they're trying to clean up a lot that's going on at DC. So we'll just see what happens. I don't know if Ron, if you're still here, if you have any thoughts on that or any better insight to what we have. But yeah, that's that story. I don't think, do we have anything else after that? I feel like we had one more, but I don't remember.
Nope.
No, that's
next,
it.
Next week's books.
So our pools, and I don't have yours up, so you got to tell me if there's anything I'm missing from yours.
There's only one, the Boom book.
Okay. So we got Amazing Spider-Man number 48. It's the part four of the Sin Rising. Again, this is a super dark arc right now. It's freaking awesome. If you're not reading it and you like Spidey, I would definitely pick it up. The series has definitely switched gears into like happy jolly to dark and sinister. So it's really fun. We have our last Empire tie-in with Captain Marvel, number 21. We're going to find out. I think we're going to find out that L'Oreal, Danvers' half-sister, is probably going to be the new Accuser. That's my spec. You tell me what you think, but that's what I think.
I don't think so.
You don't think so?
No, I don't think she's going to yet. I think she's going to have to make a decision on whether she's going to stay accuser and stay with Teddy, or if she's going to give up the weapon and go back to whatever she was doing. I think we can assume that she is not going to stay with Teddy, especially because she is smack dab in the middle of Jason Aaron's Avengers arc.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know how you would reconcile that, but I don't know.
Her sister's going to be the Accuser. All right. Then we got our two Fallout and Aftermath issues, Avengers. So Empire Aftermath Avengers number one. I think we're going to get an official wedding between Teddy and his boyfriend? Wiccan. But what's his official name?
I don't know.
Oh, yeah. and then we have Empire Fallout Fantastic Four. This is going to be us kind of getting into the new family dynamic and the new Kree Skrull Alliance. I'm super excited. I'm actually really excited about this. I think we're going to get more information and more action out of these two issues than we actually got in the series. And that just, like, it's cool, but it sucks too, because I was just wanted more out of that. Marauders 12. Will we finally get revenge from Shaw killing the Red Queen?
I certainly hope so, but I absolutely hate this cover.
I can't agree with you more. I don't like it either. I don't like her with curly hair. I don't know what it is. I just don't.
Well, she's always had curly hair, but that's like a perm.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like, it's like, whoa. But, you know, it's Ten of Swords tie-in. Let's bring it. Let's do it. So, see what happens. Star 5, I don't think I reviewed Star 4 on this, so I don't know if I'm going to review this book, but we'll see. I might read 4 and then review just overall Star in general. So this wraps up Star. This one, I cannot wait for it, and I think I have it on my pull list. If I don't, Ron, please put it on my pull list. Please, 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 please. Web of Venom Wraith, number 1.
Yeah.
I am super looking forward to this one. I know it's actually been out on digital for a while, but I've tried really hard not to read it because I want to read it in a physical copy. And I'm ready for the King in Black. I'm ready for Null. I'm ready for Venom. I'm ready for anything and all of it. I'm ready, 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 ready.
Who told you this is available on digital?
I saw somebody that, I think it was Thinking Critical when I was like diving down that rabbit hole. Somebody said that it was already available on digital.
So Marvel accidentally released it on Marvel Unlimited for like 2 hours and then pulled it down.
Ah, so, well, that person read it, so.
Yeah.
And I immediately stopped watching it when he started talking about it. I was like, nope, 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 nope. I don't want to know. So there's that. I really want that. X-Factor number 3. We're going to deal with more Mojoverse. I know that, so get ready for that, Nate. Just get through it. We'll just get through it. We'll get through it, because then the next issue is Ten of Swords, so. And the cover for number 4 is the 5 looking absolutely horrified that somebody's coming out of a husk on fire, so let's get it. And then I am also looking forward to this, just because I love this series, X-Force number 12. I'm probably going to predict that that's probably going to be my pick of the week already, but we'll see. The only thing that's not on here that I'm debating picking up is there is a DC death metal tie-in issue, one-off, that comes out. Let me see. I'm going to pull it up. Because it just looks really cool to me. And I think the cover itself makes me want to pick it up. But the storyline sounds kick-ass too. And again, I don't know a lot about DC, but I kind of want to pick this up. So it's the Dark Knight's Death Metal Trinity Crisis. Sounds cool. And the cover looks badass.
That's a Snyder book too, right?
I believe so. Yep.
So, I mean, he's the one writing the whole event. The story is probably going to be pretty good.
So it's not on my pull list, but I'll probably, you know, if there's an extra copy, I'm probably going to pick it up when we get our books. So that is one that I'm thinking about. And then the other one that, again, I'm super on the fence. I'm super, super on the fence. But I can't not think about not picking up an Alex Ross cover. And that is Ultraman number 1.
Oh, right.
The Rise of Ultraman. We'll see. I don't think I'm going to pick it up, but it's you know, if I find a couple quarters under the couch,
yeah,
I might pick it up. So there's that one. So what's the other book that you
The only book I have that you don't is Something Is Killing the Children number 10.
Oh, that's, so we can already tell that's going to be your pick of the week.
Probably. We're going to get a big confrontation in this one, and I think I think whatever happens in this book is going to shape a lot of what's going to happen after this.
Okay. I might need to borrow yours just so I can get caught up.
Yeah. I mean, at least borrow the trade at first. If you don't like that, then you don't have to keep up, but trade has first six issues in it.
Okay. I'll do it. Sure. Let's do it. All right, cool. Well, that's next week. Again, we appreciate you guys watching. We really enjoy doing the show and being able to talk comics. You know, me and Nate try really hard not to talk to each other through the week so we can have fresh ideas for the show. And, you know, our viewership every week gets a little bit bigger and bigger every week, and we really, really do appreciate everyone that watches. We want to continue to bring you good content. We want to continue to talk about comics to y'all. So please, please, continue to watch. If you're not following us on Twitch, we do encourage you to follow us. Just click that follow button. That's all you got to do. We're trying to get to 50 so we can get to affiliate and just continue to grow the channel. And then also, if you're not following us on Facebook or Instagram, we're there. You can follow us and like us there. And we also have a YouTube page where we post past episodes there too. So if you didn't catch something, or you know, you're just getting to this late, you can always catch those episodes. I try to get those up like 1 or 2 days after the episode. So again, go support your LCS, shop local, go buy comics, and when you're out, please, for goodness sake, wear a mask. And also, this November, go vote. I'm not going to tell you who to vote for, but go vote. We'll talk to you guys later.